morning. I'd like to welcome all of you to the funeral services of Robert Mark Mathiasen. All those that have traveled far or come just around the corner, I'd like to welcome all of you in honoring this fine man today with this funeral services. These funeral services are being held today, Saturday, January 20th, 2018, at 11 a.m. I am Bishop Crandall. I am going to be conducting. Just previous to this, we were able to gather for a family prayer. And we will open this meeting by singing a congregational hymn, 113. I would like to thank Sister Evelyn Harris and Emily Shurtleff for providing music. After the opening hymn, the opening prayer will be given by Joanne Wright. Following Sister Wright, there will be a musical recording, Dancing in the Sky. Following the musical recording, the life sketch will be given by Sunny Kern, followed by a speaker, Robert Ford. After he concludes, there will be a musical recording, When I Get Where I'm Going. Following that musical recording, Al Knox will address us, followed by another musical recording, Go Rest High on That Mountain. When that concludes, I will add some closing remarks, and the closing hymn will be hymn number 152, God be with you till we meet again. The closing prayer will then be offered by Brother Jeff Blaine, and the interment will take place in the Shelley Hillcrest Cemetery, and Brother John Lott will give the dedicatory prayer over the grave. We'll begin. The pallbearers, let me read this real quick. The pallbearers are Russ Hall, Larry Kohler, Gary Strander, Sonny Kern, Bruce Benedict, and Al Knox, with honorary pallbearers Robert Ford and Todd Roberts. We'll begin with the opening.
we've had the opportunity to get to know Mark. We are grateful that we can join together today and celebrate his life. We thank thee, Father, for our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and his atoning sacrifice that makes it possible that we will see each other again. We ask a special blessing today on Cheryl and the family and everyone that loved him, that their sorrow might be replaced soon with joy and happiness. These favors and blessings we ask in the name of thy Son, Jesus Christ, amen.
first time for me. So pray for me. I'm not going to look at Cheryl because I'm gonna, just going to start crying if I do. Anyway, my name's Sonny. I've been on pins and needles since she contacted me last Tuesday. And Sonny, would you please do the life sketch for Mark? I would like to take a moment to thank Mark's wife, Cheryl, for allowing me the privilege of sharing Mark's life sketch. Mark and I talked a lot, and he told me he grew up in the Salt Lake Valley. He was raised in the LDS religion. He had shared several stories about growing up there. He told me when he was younger, he used to ride his bike all over the valley, and they referred to him as Hell on Wheels. He became an excellent skier on the hills east, on the east side of the valley. He loved all kinds of sports, and really enjoyed rugby. Believe that. Those of you who knew him, how big he was, he enjoyed that sport. And to this day, he's got a nose that goes this way because of a very hard match one day down there. And that wasn't the first or the last time. That wasn't the last time he broke his nose anyway. He tried to teach me to ski one day, and that didn't work out too well. I was just a little bit too old at the time. I met Mark in 1986. I've known him for 32 years. He was a salesman at C.F. Landreau Ford at the time. I had talked to Mark on occasion, and when I would return a detailed car to the dealership, we would talk and we became kind of friends. And I'd been talking to him on and off for a few months. Before I continue, I must share with all of you that at that time I was a member of Alcoholics Anonymous, and I had been sober for 5 years. And I'd shared that a couple times with Mark. But one day, something was very wrong. Mark was in a lot of emotional pain, I could tell that. He asked me if I had a moment to talk, and we walked outside of the showroom. He shared with me the night before he had gotten very drunk and anger had overtaken him. He put his fist through a door, something like that. For those of you who knew him 32 years ago, he was a very big and a very powerful man. He shared with me at one time he had been the bouncer at the Westerner Bar on Redwood Road in Salt Lake City. And he shared with me how he used to take people out with one of those metal folding chairs. I shared something with Mark that I had heard in an AA meeting. Anger is the wind that blows out the light of the mind. And he related to that. I told Mark there was a way to live life one day at a time and to do it without the use of alcohol. I said sometimes that I would have to shorten that up to a 24-hour period. Other times, just an hour at a time. And sometimes 5 minutes at a time, as I was living my life at that time. I told him it was so simple. You can't get drunk if you don't take the first drink. They refer to that as KISS, K-I-S-S, keep it simple, stupid. I told Mark there was a meeting that night. This was on a Wednesday. And it started at 7:30. That was incorrect. The meeting didn't start till 8. He was mad at me for that for a long time. I told him that. Luckily, there's a friend of mine there. His name was Rick, and Rick was a coffee maker. He was there at 7:30. And he said, hi to Mark. He said, my name's Rick, come on in. And somehow, Rick managed to get him to stay at that meeting. Mark and I became very close friends. I introduced him to bird hunting. I can't believe that or not. Behind my two German wire hair pointers, spooks and schnapps. He loved to watch the dogs work and how they could hold the bird while they were on point. Years later, he started to raise his own German Shorthairs with another dog lover, his wife, Cheryl. I introduced him to fly fishing and how to tie his own flies. He was excellent at both. We had a day on Henry's Lake with several of our friends that we could never match. This was years ago. We'd been up fishing the Island Park Reservoir the day before. The next morning we decided we'd go fish Wild Rose. Wind was coming out of the south, and there were whitecaps there on the lake, and we could not put our float tubes in. Somebody suggested, let's go over to the cliffs, so we did. We got over there at the cliffs because that's the south side of the lake. There was, the water was just calm, flat, and we could see these dimples all over the water. The fish were feeding on a damselfly hatch. We all put our float tubes in, we started catching fish like crazy. And Mark is stubborn as he, no, yeah, well, he was stubborn. He went off by himself, and he thought he'd try his flies. And we're over there, and we are just having an unbelievable time. I had damselflies hatching off the back of my net, on my float tube. Mark finally came over and said, what are you fishing with? I'm fishing with a double renegade. You want to try one? And he got into fishing as well. We hunted geese on many occasions. We were done with a hunt one day, and we were along the edge of the American Falls Reservoir. And I watched some geese out there doing this with their wings. So I got this bright idea, and I went home and I made a mechanical little thing out of a black t-shirt, and it wiggled its wings. So the next day we went goose hunting, and I set this thing up, and Mark says, if that thing scares the geese away, you're going to take it out of the blanket and plunge. Believe it or not, they wanted to sit down on that thing. And I really screwed up. I should have patented that thing years ago. We even went elk hunting one time up in the Sawtooths. The year before, Mark got an elk. They're all camoed up and everything, and he started bugling. And we heard an elk respond. We heard him getting a little closer. I was so nervous and shaking, I don't think I could have knocked an arrow. The elk never showed up. Anyway, on our many drives to hunt and fish, we would talk about living life on life's terms. We would share what we had learned and what was working for us. At that time, we attended a ton of AA meetings. We learned that we could not keep what we had been freely given unless we gave it away. We also learned that we had to accept that we had a higher power in our lives, a power we called God of our own understanding. We discovered that we were God's kids, and He don't make no junk. One of the things we learned, when we became teachable, the teachers would arrive. One of those teachers was a guy from California. His name was Hal. Hal, he was big and tall like Mark, one of the most intelligent men I've ever met. Hal really liked Big Mark and kind of took him under his wing. Hal shared many things with Mark and with me, and one of them was wholeness, just the word wholeness. He said, to be whole, we would need a God to trust, a work we could do, someone to love, and a right to serve others. Mark and I have been trying to do that to this day. You see, you're making me serve others right now. Hal also told us the three things that we must know for him and I to live. Number one, that alcoholism is an irreversible disease. Unless it is arrested, it will take my life and my sanity. Two, I have to believe that I've got it. Three, I have to believe that AA has the answer for it. And if I believe these three things, I can have it and it is life. Mark called me a sponsor. He would share his problems with me at times, and I would ask him what his solutions were. Only on a few occasions, I would have to remind him that your solutions are worse than your problems. Mark's life took a dramatic turn in 1997 when he met and married Cheryl. As an observer, I can tell you, I have never seen a couple so devoted to each other. I know that they have enriched each other's lives immensely. Through the dogs that Mark and Cheryl raised, they have made many friends and have enriched many people's lives. To be totally honest, I have to share some of my anger and pain. I do not like to go to hospitals. I do not like to see my friends there. That is one of the toughest things in my life that I have to do today. And as I get older, I'm losing more and more of my friends. My friend. Mark and I often talked about bird hunting. After we retired 4 years ago, even at that time, he and I couldn't go hunting. Many trips to North Dakota were planned to help ease the pain I know now, when we meet again, I will have the opportunity to fulfill those dreams with him. Mark and I had a couple of other sayings that we live by: trust God, clean house, and help others. And from one of our old friends, we called him the old Indian. His name was Jerry Z. Jerry would always get up and speak at a meeting, and he'd say, honesty, open-mindedness, and willingness. As an example, I'm going to share a story I forgot about. A friend of mine reminded me of this just the other day. Mark and I used to frequent a coffee shop back in the day. There was a young waitress there who was a single mom. Her name was Amy. I was hoping she was going to be here today. On one of our visits, just before Christmas, as Amy approached the booth, there was a very large Barbie doll sitting next to Mark for her three-year-old daughter. She shared with me Thursday evening that the Barbie doll was about 2 feet taller than her daughter. Of course she cried. Yes, she cried when I told her last Wednesday that we lost Mark. But what brought more tears was the $100 bill that Mark had left under his coffee cup. As my wife likes to say, he was just that kind of a guy. We had to deliver some dogs one day up in northern Idaho. Maybe it was just one, I can't remember, but we had the boat behind. We had 5 dogs delivered that day. Holy smokes, it's been a long time. And after we delivered the dogs, we camped out, and the next day we went steelhead fishing. There's a beautiful picture I have that I believe you took of me and that steelhead that I caught that day. And Mark took care of my wife because she was kind of tippy getting in and out of the boat. And from that day to this, she refers to him as Captain Tuna. Mark has shared his experience, strength, and hope with many people and helped them to recover from a seemingly hopeless state of mind and body. For this next portion, I must tell you how an AA meeting is run. I'm not sure how many people in here have ever been to one, but there's always a chairman who opens the meeting, and he gives out announcements and chips and things like that. We give out chips for one day of sobriety, 30 days, 60 days, and so on. And then we have a secretary there who takes care of the announcements. The week before Mark passed, I was in the hospital visiting him. We were the only ones in the room, and he shared a dream that he had the night before. He had dreamt that he had died and gone to heaven. St. Peter was waiting for him at one of the 12 gates. St. Peter said, "I see your name is written in the book of life. Well done, good and faithful servant. You have fulfilled all my wishes for you. Please come in. Please take that path, and you will find a door with the letters AA above the door. There are several people waiting for you." Mark found the door and walked in. Gathered inside was Buckshot B, Arnold T, Ted B, Ted H, Old Doris, M. Hal was there, Barry W, Bill D, the Pie Thief, Jerry Z, LeVan N, Pat G, Lyle S, Wes P, Wendell A, Howard and Sharon N, and Rick the Coffee Maker, and many others. Buckshot walked up to Mark, shook his hand and said, "Welcome, we've been waiting for you. We have some good news and we have some bad news. What would you like first?" "I would like," Mark said, "I guess I'd like to have the good news first. Well, we have a pheasant hunt lined up for you with Fritz and Greta. And we have just gotten a fresh supply of pheasants from North Dakota. We also have a shiny Harley ready for you to ride when you're rested up from a hunt." All he could say was, "Wow. Okay, what is the bad news?" "We have a meeting scheduled here for a week from this Monday. Monday night, it starts at 9 p.m. The bad news is, you are on the schedule to chair that meeting." That meeting was last Monday night. I can only hope I have conveyed in some small way just a few of the many accomplishments and successes that my friend Mark achieved during his life. He has reached out to help many people. I would like to leave you with this. It is from the television series Touched by an Angel to the actress Della Reese. What is he leaving behind that will last? What is he leaving behind that will last? Her answer was, "Some of our best living is done through the people we leave behind. Some of our best living is done through those of us in this room that he's leaving behind. Thank you, my friend. I love you, brother."
Showed up. Mark would love this. He wouldn't like the people crying, and he wouldn't like people paying attention to him, but all the friends together and in one place would be a mind-blowing experience for him, to be real honest. I've known Mark for 28 years. Larger than life guy. You know, I had no idea, but and he did immediately. And he didn't like a lot of people immediately. He really wants. And he had this way of life that was so very foreign to me. I mean, I had a good life, don't get me wrong, but I was raised with my emotion, with God. Nobody ever talked about love, that's for damn sure. And there was this huge man's man that I really liked, and some of the most important things he ever talked about was love. It always blew me away, because guys didn't talk about that, you know? And he was there, and he helped me get through that situation, you know? And at the same time, I was playing sports, and Mark liked sports. And I don't think he missed one of my games. I really don't think he did. He may have. And he'd be there with my mom and my dad, and he just really loved watching me play football. And he'd sit there and PS afterwards, and it was a magical moment every time. It's one of the saddest things, is I always wanted to spend time with Mark, and life interfered. You know. But he taught me a lot of things about life, you know. Anger is the wind that blows out the light of the mind. He says I stole it, but that's all right. Sonny did too. So, you know. He introduced me to people, and you know, I'm kind of a quieter person. And if I don't don't know you, I'm really probably not going to talk to you. If you talk to me, I'm going to wonder what you want. You really are. He was gregarious, and he got along with people, and I always admired that about him. It didn't matter who he was talking to. 5 seconds later, they were his best freaking friends, and I never understood how he did that, you know what I'm saying? Middle of nowhere on a motorcycle ride, getting gas, and some guy pulls up, and I don't even know. Mark all said his best friends with the guy. Hey, come meet this guy. Blah, blah, blah. You know, it was just always amazing, and it made people laugh. And he had his... I always thought he looked at life and found it to be kind of a poor joke, ironically, and he was just going to make the absolute best out of what he had and just drive on. I admired that. I really did. I really can't tell you all how absolutely wonderful Mark was, some of you know. I'm kind of sad that the whole world didn't get to meet the guy to be real on. He wouldn't have liked it, but he would have. I went overseas. Joined the United States military, airborne infantry, who y'all. And Mark was worried, but he didn't want me to know he was worried, but I knew. And I kept in touch with him through basic, airborne school, got sent overseas, to Chile, Italy. And we were going to war, Bosnia, 1995. And it's kind of funny, the last step through the 18-hour sequence when you go to war is you load your magazines, you make sure you got all your ammo, and you start sewing it away, and the next thing you do is you get in chalk order, you get on a bird, and you either jump or you get off, whatever. And I'm scared to death, I'm a private, and I just don't want to do anything wrong. I'm scared to death where we're going. And I'm loading my mags, and all of a sudden I hear, Private Ford! And I look up, because who the hell wants me, you know what I'm saying? And I run up there, and there's a box. I don't know how I got mail at the last possible stage before we go to more, but I get mail. And it's just a little box, and it's from Mark. And he sent me a fighting knife. Great big Gerber fighting knife, right? Little teeny note that says, hey, if you're sticking in somebody, watch out, because the back part has these big serrations, and if it's stuck. Really, I'm not even making this up. I've been all over the place with the Army afterwards, and I've never seen anybody get mail while you're getting ammo to go to war. It's not a priority for the Army. But Mark was special, and he was magical, and he just went all of a sudden. It calmed me, because I was not calm. I was trying to play hips looking cool, but I wasn't really calm, you know what I'm saying? I don't think anybody else was. But just getting the knife and a little teeny note, and all of a sudden everything was all right, you know? Got on the bird and we went and did our job. Came back, and I hadn't been able to keep in touch with Mark because I was always overseas. I kept in touch, and even though it cost $1 million, Mark was, I called my parents and I called Mark. That's pretty much it. And I got back here and he'd met this girl named Cheryl. I didn't know who the hell Cheryl was, but I did. And he loved the living daylights out of her. I was like, wow, man, this ought to be interesting. Got to come down to Idaho Falls and link up with Mark and everything. Now there's a wedding, and he has this horrible neuropathy where his legs feel like they're on fire. It really tore him up too, probably way more than me. And so I kind of sat about that, and then there's this wedding thing, and Sonny's there, and it was just a magical afternoon. It really was. I'm so glad I actually got back from the Army, because I wasn't really supposed to be back yet. I got hurt. Otherwise, I'd have been stuck in Fort Bragg, North Carolina. And at that wedding, it was after that all of a sudden Mark and I started getting to do stuff again. Like back when I was in college. It was awesome, And he introduced me to motorcycles, which is probably one of the greatest gifts he ever gave me in some ways. Strange as that may sound. And he knew how to ride. He always kept that kind of quiet for me. I didn't really understand how much he'd done in motorcycles and stuff. Next thing I know, we're buying motorcycles, and every time we can, we're getting together just to ride a motorcycle. I mean, to hang out, but motorcycles are there, And he taught me how to ride a motorcycle, because I kind of knew. Keep it pointed forward and try to keep the rubber on the road and don't hit anything solid. So I had it down a little bit. But Mark could ride like the wind, He got on that bike, and was following him because I tried to learn how to take tracks through corners and all that throughout, you know, for his example. And man, those trips were awesome. We saw some of the most beautiful territory, sunrises, sunsets, meeting weird people at gas stations and markets along the way. Just absolutely amazing trips. Never got enough of them. And then I got hurt and can't work anymore and some things happened physically, but you know. But then Mark couldn't ride. Because I had all the free time in the world, all of a sudden I was excited, you know. And then Mark couldn't ride and that tore him apart. You know, and towards the end, I asked if I could buy his bike, because it's Mark's bike. I could buy another bike, but I don't want another bike, I want Mark's bike, you know. And he agreed, and he didn't really want to agree, because he was going to keep that bike in the garage till he died, but he thought it would be cool that I'd have his bike, and he thought it would be cool every time I'm riding it, Mark's riding it too. So, vicariously, he got a lot more riding. And, I don't know how long that took. But Mark was an amazing person. I love him. I can't even describe it. You know. And Cheryl, he was right. I was a little concerned at first, but you're good. And just again, really want to thank you all for coming. Mark would really like you. He wouldn't want any of us sad. He wanted everybody to kind of get together and talk about love and peace and God and all kinds of. Go find some people we don't know and start talking to them. So I'd like to thank you for the opportunity, the honor, really, to speak about Mark. I didn't do a good enough job, and I knew it wouldn't want to get here. But he knows, and I know, Cheryl knows. So thank you very much, and I will now shut up.
Hello, everybody. I'm Al Knox. Mark was another brother from another mother. I first met Mark, it was in the spring of 93, at a meeting in Chile. And I remember standing out in front of the doors and out comes this great big guy. And he just kind of overtook everybody, you know, just his presence overtook everybody. And then I was meeting him at certain meetings, different times, and we had a connection that you don't get with a lot of people. We just had that connection that we were just right there all the time. And even when we wasn't together, I would call or he'd call, and it was like we'd start right from the very beginning. We'd be right there. You know, one of the things that always would tell me that Mark was around, his laugh. That laugh. Ha! 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 You know, that man, we were on a ride one time, riding our bikes, and I met him up at a place in Montana because he was going somewhere else and I just met him there. And then we took off riding from there. And the road, it was a little windy because, you know, like Mark and me, we always like kicking. He called the goat trails. We're going on the goat trails. Stay away from the freeways and most of the highways if you can. And just go pick your way through the, you know, the area. And it was either going full bore or we got scared and decided we better slow down a little bit. Mark, I love that man. One time I got a call from him. I was headed to the meeting in Perth. He goes, "You riding to the meeting?" I said, "Yeah." "Well, can you stop by my place first?" You know, and he's in Chile. And I'm in Wapello, so I, "Yeah, I need a little help." Well, he got out in front of his driveway in the gravel. He had to stop and he put a foot down and his bike went down. He couldn't get it up. So I pulled up out there and he goes, "Yo, you're the only one I couldn't be real embarrassed by calling." I said, "Well, I'm real big. I'll just pick it up myself." And between the two of us, we got the bike up, and then we rode into the meeting. You know, it was little things like that that it was just like we were connected. You know, that... met him up in Salmon one time because I rode with some guys that were there's a clean and sober group called the Fifth Chapter, and we were all getting together up in Salmon. So we met down in Salmon, and then was riding up to the place where we was camping. Well, Mark had a problem getting around this one corner to go down the hill across the bridge, and bike tipped over on him again. He'd already tipped it over and down in Salmon at the motel, but there it broke his leg or his ankle or something. It broke something, ankle. So we get the bike up and get him down in there, and then got him. Then he got back to the motel and figured out that his ankle was broke. So we had to, Cheryl, I had to go back to Idle Falls, pick up a trailer, and come back and get him and everything while he was there. And on the way home, And Leslie, the wind was bad. I mean, it was real bad. When you're riding like this, and then when it stopped, you'd almost fall over. But Leslie's bike had broken off. It stopped down on the road just before Robert's. And lo and behold, here comes Cheryl, and they parked so that the wind didn't knock the bikes over. And we got it going again and got into Robert's. And she'd had enough. She said, I'm not riding anymore. Because it was the first time we'd ever went on a long ride where she was riding her own bike. And that next day after we went and got her bike and got her home and everything, then when I got a hold of Mark, he's going, oh, what was going on? What'd you do? You know, because he was gruff but loving. And if you didn't get that gruff part, he didn't love you. And that's just the way it was. So he hadn't known what was going on, and then we had to find out how he was doing. I said, well, Gimp, if you could keep the rubber side down all the time, because you know, you gotta jab the people that you love. It's just not right if you don't. But we would talk off and on, and he'd call me or I'd call him, and it'd usually last until one of our batteries were dead. And it was that connection that I had with him. I believe he had it with me too, because we wouldn't talk to each other for a while, and then when we did, it was like we started up right there at the same spot. When he got his bike and we were doing some changing on it, he picked up a lift that he could lift the bikes up with, and he was proud of that. Oh my God, he was real proud of that. So I came over, we were changing the handlebars out, so we had to change all the wiring and everything. It took us longer than most people, because we finally had to break out the book and start reading some stuff. Because we decided that we didn't know everything, which we always thought we did before, you know. But doing things like that, it was just, we worked together. And I always told him, I said, yeah, you're just a brother from another mother. Watching as his health was dwindling, and he couldn't do the things that he wanted to do, you could see that just the pain in his eyes, in his whole demeanor. The second time before, well, we'd stopped up to his place not too long ago. And another friend, Danny, was picking up a bed. And I saw him, and I just, you know, because when I first met Mark, he's a big guy. And then that day when I saw him, he looked more like me. I said, what? You trying to look like, you're just trying to, you know, assimilate the same look as I got, Mark. You know, and that's hard to see. But you know, that even through all the stuff that he went through, he was always caring for somebody else. You know, that loud voice, that big laugh, I'll never forget. Night before last, I had a dream. I heard that voice. And I heard that laugh. So I knew he was all right. You know, I knew he just stopped by to tell me that he was okay. And I told him then, in the dream, I said, we'll ride some more roads together, brother. You keep it ready for me. I'll be there. Hopefully not very soon, but I'll be there. But I love that man, and I'm glad all of you guys are here. Thank you.